Amanda presents this unabridged recording of The Thousandth Brumby, Silver Brumby, Book 12, written by Elyne Mitchell and read by Caroline Lee. The dedication reads, "For John, who took me to Beloka." Chapter 1. Always a loner, from the time he was born. Birds of a feather stick together, but there were no birds of his feather. Until that bronze cuckoo called up the dog that was sitting on the ground by the dead stockman. The Brumbies that were watching saw the dog cock his ears up at the bronze cuckoo's whistle. They saw the dog join that loner Brumby, saw them both melt into thick bush. The black Brumby with four white legs and the black and blue dog with the white paws. The black Brumby with the four white legs saw the dog following and felt glad of its company, thinking that dog might be a good friend. Something told him that there was going to be a fierce storm, and there would be room for a dog, too, under the overhanging rock that he knew would be a good place to stay. He began to trot. The dog kept the same distance behind him. Then the bronze cuckoo began to call again from up near that overhanging rock. Now Socks trotted faster. The dog closed the distance between them a little. They were nearly at the overhanging rock above Cascade Creek when the first raindrop started to fall. Socks went faster and came to shelter under the rock before he got really wet. Then he heard the dog howling. He trotted back, nudged the dog towards the sheltering rock. The bronze cuckoo called again and was quiet. The black and blue dog lay down under the overhang, and after a while, Socks lay down beside him as the rain grew harder, and they were snug and warm. Black dog crept closer to Socks until they warmed each other. Then the thunder and lightning started. The black and blue dog's name, given him by his stockman owner, was Lightning, because he hated lightning and thunder. So with the first crash and flash of the storm, he wriggled in closer to Socks. In his sleep, Socks felt the warm dog against his chest, and without knowing he did it, wrapped his legs a little tighter around the dog. Crack, crash, went the thunder and lightning, and the dog growled. Down poured the rain, but they were warm and dry. The storm blew and thundered all through the night, and it quietened just as dawn was coming. The dog woke and gently licked Socks's nose. Dawn came creeping over Paradise Hill, above the Cascade Valley. A few Brumbies began to wander out of the sheltering bush. Lightning watched them. Socks made no move to join them. None of them were friends of his. In fact, he did not have any friends. Suddenly, he felt that Lightning was his friend, and these other horses might chase him. He had better watch out for Lightning, but he needed to get a drink. He stood up and moved out from under the rock. The other Brumbies began moving towards him. A small rabbit appeared, shaking rain out of its coat. Lightning was hungry, and here was something to eat. He sprang after it. Socks watched him catch it and begin to eat. The other Brumbies crept closer. Lightning looked up and saw them. Perhaps they were coming after his food. Low to the ground, he moved forward and then leapt after the leaders, rounding them up and sending them right up the valley. Socks watched with pleasure and amusement. He and Lightning were friends for life, and the other Brumbies should know it. Just as the herd of Brumbies went galloping up the snowgrass valley of the Cascade Creek, Socks saw a movement on a little mound opposite. There was a slab and shingle hut there, he knew, and the door of the hut flew open. Two men burst out. "Lightning, come here!" one yelled. Lightning stopped dead and swung round to where he knew Socks was standing. Socks found himself neighing to the dog, his friend, and in a second, Lightning sprang around, picked up his half-eaten young rabbit, and tore back towards Socks. The two of them crept off together through the wet scrub to another good hiding place that Socks had seen before. "If only they don't have dogs to look for us," Socks thought, and turned his head down to nose Lightning. The dog licked his nose, then jumped up and put a paw on Socks's leg. They would be friends now forever. Socks stopped for a minute at a little pool and had a drink. Lightning ate the remaining hind leg of his rabbit and felt much better. Now they could go on to whatever lay ahead. Plenty lay ahead. Socks suspected that the two men would saddle up their horses and come after them. Lightning had the same sort of feeling, and there was no way that he was going to be caught. His owner had died, he knew that, and the voice of the man who had called his name was that of a bad man. He had seen him in action before, and he didn't want anything to do with him. Now that he had a good friend, he meant to stick to him. When they stopped once for Socks to listen and wonder, Lightning put up a paw to Socks's dear face. Then the two friends went on, creeping rather silently along the hillsides, till they came to a cavern that Socks knew existed. A good shelter should it storm again, and well hidden. A flock of black cockatoos flew overhead. They knew, just like Socks and Lightning did, that more bad weather was coming. Any tracks Socks and Lightning might have made would be washed out. A spring gushed out of the hill just below their cave and ran round a swamp into quite a large creek. They had a good hiding place. There were plenty of seed-bearing bushes surrounding a little grassy flat where rabbits usually played. Socks and Lightning would have enough food for a few days and plenty of water, and the call of the bronze cuckoo to tell them to stay. It was the start of Socks's life of being the wildest Brumby of them all. Socks and Lightning's great combination was of brains and cunning, of teeth and hooves. Lightning had loved his master, the master who whistled like a bronze cuckoo, but he had learnt enough about men and cattle to be determined not to be caught again by any others. He and Socks would be quite a fearsome team, a fighting dog and maybe a fighting Brumby, a pair that knew the mountains well. Rain began again, then came the first roll of thunder. The two men had followed in their general direction, but found no tracks. Now Lightning was snug and warm with Socks. His old master had called him Lightning, but had always comforted him in a storm. Now Socks comforted him when there was thunder and lightning. Lightning felt safe and happy with Socks, and for the first time in his loner's life, Socks felt secure in companionship with Lightning. They stayed in their cave. A low growl from Lightning told Socks that the men had come fairly close, then turned back. One man's voice drifted up to him. "I'd like that dog. A real good worker." Another voice answered, "He mightn't work for ye. Forget it." You're right. Let's go back. The sky was bright with lightning. The dog crept closer against Socks. Socks nosed him gently. No one was going to harm Lightning. Thunder crashed, but they heard the men turn back. Lightning stayed very quiet. Time later to get up and hunt another rabbit when they came out to play. By evening, a greenish rift came in the clouds. The storm might be over. Horse and dog stood at the cave opening looking out. Then Socks made up his mind, nosed Lightning to follow, and set off to the ridge above. There was no track, but the going would be good for quite some distance. Socks knew the way well. There might be a track of sorts up the Leather Barrel Creek, but he did not know if there would be other horses owning that deep valley. There would be water and shrubs to eat, but he really did not know if there would be rabbits for Lightning to hunt. Surely there would be rabbits. He turned his head to touch Lightning, glad of his company. Lightning was glad too, and jumped up to greet him. A bar of sunlight fell on the dog's coat, showing up the touch of blue on his shoulder. Blue Healer, savage but faithful, and a touch of dingo with his pricked ears. Socks went on happily. The scrub was getting more dense. They crossed two small creeks. Lightning splashed about, catching floating leaves and sticks. Then he snapped up a little rainbow trout, but he wasn't really sure how to eat it. They now crossed a bigger creek, the Leather Barrel. And then the going got rougher, more difficult, with thick grevillea shrubs, difficult for Lightning to move through. Even Socks' legs got tangled up, but on they went. Then, through the snow gum branches, Socks saw a stallion standing on a snow grass spur that came down off the ram's head. The stallion looked fairly fierce, and a few shadowy mares were melting into the bush behind him. Lightning gave a deep growl. The stallion seemed to offer a fight. Socks wasn't really interested in fighting that powerful-looking stallion. He only wanted to clear any Brumbies out of the head of the Leather Barrel Creek, so he trotted up purposefully. Lightning knew immediately what he meant to do and shot past him, barking. The stallion stood for a moment, astonished. Then he turned and galloped away, Lightning nipping at his heels. Socks went after him too, got round him, but then as the stranger stopped, he realized he could leave Lightning to deal with him. Because as the strange stallion stood still, Lightning sprang and fastened his teeth in his nose. The stallion shook him off, but Socks was there to chase him up the valley, striking at him. The stallion stopped once and turned on Socks, striking him sharply above the shoulder. Socks grabbed him on the wither, and just then Lightning sprang at his nose again. The stallion shook him off and went tearing up a faint Brumby track to one side of the head wall, following his mares. Lightning and Socks followed up on their advantage, Lightning getting in some savage bites on the stallion's heels. Socks looked up as he heard a mare neighing and just saw them on the very edge of the head wall. The next time he looked up, he saw the big stallion nearly level with the head wall. Then he heard wild neighing and stood still to watch. The mares barely took time to greet their stallion as he crested the edge of the head wall before they turned and galloped out of sight. Lightning had his nose pointing to the west, and the low rumbling in his throat told Socks that there was danger coming. Then he looked up further and saw a menacing black cloud gathering in the west and coming towards the mountains. Where to go? Up or down? There seemed to be no good cover. It was the dog who had seen an umbrella-shaped snow gum. The dog who knew immediately there was snow coming. It was Lightning who remembered sheltering under the snow gum with his master and his master's stock horse. He led his friend to the tree on the lee side of a deep.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.